Okay, well, thank you again for being here and for waiting. Before we begin to talk to one another and look at your work, we want to offer a very brief and obviously fragmented look at some moments in poetic performance that we found generative in our work, and not just in the sense of thinking up performance strategies for readings, but as methods for moving poems forward through the intervention of the performative dimension, the performative perspective. So the history of poetry is obviously tied up with the history of performance since archaic times, and a Harvard classicist, whose work I really like, Gregory Nagy, in his book Poetry as Performance, juxtaposes the complements of performance and composition to the linguistic notions of parole and langue, so speech and language, when discussing archaic Greek traditions of performance poetry. And we find this analogy useful because it paints performance not just as presentation of work already written, you know, completed on paper, or even as a chance to debut a work run it by an audience, gauge reactions, but as a kind of continuation of the poetic process. And also think about oral poetic traditions in which a poem is modified each time it's performed, and with different performers, everything changes, things are added. So the poem is a kind of work in progress, if you look at it that way. The French would say, un texte en train de se faire, whose development continues as it's performed. And of course, we all know about archaic poem songs and the lyre, and we can agree that singer-songwriters, you know, people like Dylan, Cohen, etc., continue that tradition. But how can we locate the liveliness of performance in our own work? And in Croatian and in other languages, German as well, you said, the word for song and poem is the same word. So when you say, you don't say a poet writes.
Hebrew too.
Yeah, in Hebrew as well. So you don't say a poet writes, you say a poet sings. Such and such. I guess the question is, how do we develop our poetics through performance? What happens when we think of each public reading not just as an opportunity to pick and showcase a collection of poems, but to actually develop a performative poetics? To say that poetry begins on the page, I think, is false. So first of all, poems begin in the body. They're engendered in the mind, processed through our fingers, and they're often recited as they're written. How many of you read poems aloud to yourself as you write? Right? So it's a physical process. So we just want to share with you, we just want to like do a whirlwind tour of performance and poetry in the 20th century. So starting with Whitman, whose poems, even on the page, embody the liveliness of the written word. Of the spoken word, I mean. And then influences of European movements like Dada and its sound poetry, Kurt Schwitters, Tristan Zara. And we want to play you, just for kicks, a performance of, you'll see what it is, but it's Marie Osmond performing Hugo Ball. And some of you might have seen this already, but it's a lot of fun.
When you know you're going to be on stage, you want to make sure that you look your best and that you're properly dressed for the part. Appearance was especially important to a gentleman named Hugo Ball. He was a poet and a leader of an artistic movement called Dada. A hat like this was part of his costume, which looked like this. The number 13 on the cardboard tube that covered his face had nothing or everything to do with his performance. Dada artists didn't claim to make sense, but they did want to make unconventional artistic statements, most of them as a form of social protest. In this case, the statement included waving a small flag while reciting a nonsensical poem. The poem was written and first performed by Hugo Ball in Zurich in 1916. And it remains to this day a classic example of what Mr. Ball called sound poetry. Here's what it sounds like. A totally imaginary language invented by Mr. Ball. Kawani jolifanto blumba o fale humbla. Grossiga mepafla habla horami gaga golman. Hai globlo aikora sula huju. Holaka holala. Alogobang, blagobang, blagobang baso futaka. Shamba uwala wasa. Olobo. Hechtada gorame sej zumbada. Wulubu susuba de uluwa susuba de tamba. Baumf. Kasagama. Baumf. It didn't make any sense, but it wasn't supposed to make any sense. But nevertheless, Mr. Ball's performance got a rousing ovation and turned out not to be a passing fancy, but a new art form, sound poetry.
So, I turned the sound all the way up. So, can you guys hear it? I don't know if we can turn the sound up here at all, but and then, you know, as far as the influences of European movements, there's obviously French surrealism, whose ethos extended to poetry, film, painting, and engendered poems such as Cocteau's Blood of a Poet that actually explored poetics. And in the US, Robert Frost, visiting Dylan Thomas. So Frost was, he had the phrase, that he said, he would say he was barding around. So this is how he made his living, in fact. As did Thomas, who read to highly pitched audiences at the 92nd Street Y, girls were throwing their bras at him, etc. I'm just going to keep moving on. So Langston Hughes, the intimate connection with jazz and blues, and then the Beats, obviously. Diane de Prima reading revolutionary letters from the back of a pickup truck. Baraka, Anne Waldman, whom we saw the other week in New York and who still sings as she performs. Audre Lorde, Black Heart's poetry, and of course, the unavoidable Allen Ginsberg. So we want to play you the Father Death Blues.
And so then we move on to kind of north in the landscape of the United States to the Black Mountain poets with Charles Olson and his projective verse, where he says, "The head by way of the ear to the syllable, the heart by way of the breath to the line, and Ed Sanders, whose performance and poetics can speak for themselves.
Ed Sanders, the old Ezra Pound triad, you know, the spanopia, melopia, and logopia. Spanopia is the way it looks on the page, and I bring the hieroglyphs to that and drawings and stuff. And melopia is how it sounds. Melopia is where the muse comes in. I think there has to be another muse invented for the electromagnetic era, and I call retentia, for the retained image on tape or on film or in the micro disc or whatever. And, I just think it's important to be able to perform your poetry well, as well as for the look good on the page, which is fantasy, and for it to appear well in the mind, which is logopoeia. Seven-string tortoiseshell lyre. The tortoiseshell is the sounding board of a cow horn or horns, and then across the bottom of the strings. And the poet will sit there with a plectrum or something to strum his keys out of the strings, and would perform his poetry. It's this hypnotic, riverine type of verse that people would listen to for hours and hours. His back goes da 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 da. And they would listen to it over and over, and I was interested in kind of building a modern instrument, electronic instrument that was small and wouldn't overwhelm the poetry. So I got these little tune synthesizers, two of them, one for each hand, with the keyboards on the fingers.
The genius was a wash, fearful of blindness, caught in a wheelchair, staring at death. The angel of mercy that gave him a year to scissor some shapes to soothe the scythe. One must study an object a long time, the genius said, to know what its sign is. The scissors were his scepter, and the cutting was as the prow of a boat to sailing away, to sailing away, to sailing away. There's a photograph which shows him sitting in his wheelchair, barefoot touching the floor, drawing with crisscross steel a shape in the gouache. His helper sits near him till he hands her the form to pin to the wall. He points with a stick how he wants it adjusted, that this way and that, minute to do on this, the last blue iris blooms at the top of its stalk. Scissor, scepter, cutting, brow, scissor, scepter, cutting, brow, scissor, scepter, cutting, brow.
That was Henri Matisse, or at least a part of it. Look it up. Actually, this is
we made this playlist for you guys.
This playlist on YouTube, so we can, we can share it later.
Okay, so then moving on to language poets, we have Charles Bernstein and Penn Sound's dedication to preserving poetic performances and the contemporary landscape. with legacies of all 20th century movements in spoken word, slam, sound poetry. And here we couldn't resist sharing Tracy Morris, who, if you guys haven't seen live, is rad.
All the missus gets her ass kicked. It's inspired by Doris Day. Look at you, young person. How do you know? I'm impressed. Those movies. Those kittens. Heels. Crinoline skirts that Doris Day's wearing in her own kitchen. Why? Why she always got a perfect line? Mrs. gets her ass kicked.
Oh.
So the tradition of the lyrical poem still reads in every kind of environment, sometimes intersecting with drama, dance, such as in the following piece by Anne Carson.
Sonnet of addressing Oscar Wilde. Hesitate. Who's that man next to George? I don't know, but she's kind of cute. You don't have to be Venus extravaganza nowadays to want to call your boyfriend she. It is mostly men who do this. Women wonder where it leaves them. Those who find ugly meanings in beautiful things are corrupt without being charming. Oscar Wilde. To Lord Alfred Douglas. Letter of July 1894. I have no words for how I love you. This question of no words, no words that are legal, no words that do the trick, no words with a shock all along the edge. How to get a shock? Apply something cold to something hot. Where to go for something cold? If it is winter, go outdoors. If it is gender, hesitate. All genders are hot. Although the one you are in will generally seem less hot than the one you are.
And finally, a few very young contemporaries. The Russian conceptualist Natalia Fedorova.
Thank you.
Is this cool, the showing the videos, or should we like skip for? We have two more short clips. Yeah, everyone's digging it. Okay, so then moving forward to New York-based filmmaker and poet Lanny Jordan Jackson.
Who are you? You look like a killer from what I see. That's what some say. You kill everyone? Sometimes. Are you insane? Sometimes. Does that make you an angel? An angel. Are you hurt?
Skip the intermission.
A little. Yes. Is it me? Yes. Yes. But I need some aspirin. Can I brush your hair? Yes.
Skip forward a bit. There's a little intermission, colorful intermission.
Quickly pushing into the digital age, Steve Rogenbuck, who is an alt-lit author and who recently performed this at Poetry Will Be Made by All in Zurich.
Is the hugging towards the end, that piece?
Hmm? Yeah, it's toward the end.
Okay, let's see.
I love you, friends.
Yeah, start here.
Okay. Crank it up! Crank it up! Everybody I see hurting, and I don't want them to hurt.
I want you to be okay. I don't know how to stop you from hurting, but I will try to do it. I wish I was better at it. I want to stand for what is right to me. I don't want to do anything that I think is bad for humans or other animals or anyone. I want to work harder than I have been. I want to be hugging you. I wish that I can take care of you somehow. I don't want you to be cold or alone. You are beautiful and deserve to feel good. Oh, God! I love hugging! I love hugging people! I love staying up all night, working on something that makes me happy. Gibbous moon, crescent moon, I love stars. I love cake! I like dancing. I like kissing you. I want to kiss you. I want to kiss you on a baseball field. I want to kiss you on a baseball field in the middle of the night. In the tunnel in the jungle gym. It's dark out and we can't see. I'm going to bring cookies and juice and we're going to eat them both.
Well, you know what they say. A cock in the hand is worth five online.
Anyway, our little tour is over. So where does this leave us today? I've read recently a quote by Paul Muldoon, who calls reading, performing, an act of creativity and criticism combined, as was the writing of the poem in the first place. So we would like to begin the workshop in the spirit of this statement, and I would love for all of you to say your name and just say like a sentence or two about your experience with reading, your relationship to reading and performance, and then we'll talk about what we're gonna do. So who wants to start? We can...
I guess I have to start because of the microphone. My name's Mary Graham. I'm very shy in front of the microphone generally, but I would like to learn how to be a better performer.
Shyness.
Hey, I'm Morgan. I don't think I've read a poem in front of anyone except my sister since like middle school, so I don't have a ton of experience. I did appear in a zine that also featured Steve Rogenbuck, so I'm glad you guys played him because I'm in no way Harvard affiliated, so I feel much more connected.
Cool.
To this space.
Excellent.
Hi, my name's Audrey Martovich, and I write poems, and I loved these performances. I don't know. I guess I too am always trying to be a different or better performer. I host things a lot, but I find when I read my own poems, I get really scared all of a sudden, and then I forget everything that I tried to do.
Hi, I'm Daniel Evans Pritchard. I'm much more comfortable hosting and running events than reading my own work, by far.
Mm-hmm.
But I've read a few times. It's nerve-wracking. It's totally totally terrifying, and I like to do it, but I hate to do it. So.
Thank you. Here, I'll just pass this on to you.
I'm Lucy Budman. I'm actually just here as a tag along with this gentleman.
Hi, I'm Mark, and I'm not a poet, but I write flash fiction, if anybody knows what that is. But if mm-hmm. you don't, it's a sister, a brother to poetry. It just has a plot, unlike poems. And yes, I publish a magazine of flash fiction, the world-known one, which you probably never heard about. But would you let us read some of our poems? If you would, if you allow me to read first, because my parking will expire pretty soon.
Hi, I'm Pelly. I'm not really a practicing poet. I'm more like a poetry scene person. So I haven't really read before.
Hello, I'm Leah. I've never read publicly. I did once FedEx a poem with a receipt.
I'm Judy. I guess my experience performing and the way that I see performing is different from my experience reading my own work. It's not the same.
How is it different? If I can ask.
I guess it's hard to say, but I think I feel more engaged with an audience when I've performed in other ways, but reading my own work, I do get very shy and very scared, and it just happens, and I seem to not even be there, and then it's over.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hi, my name is Kevin. I have read numerous times. It's always terrifying. Yet at the same time, I still do it. I guess what I want to say is that I think it's important for me, why I'm here, is that I desperately need to understand what performance can look like other than the traditional reading mm-hmm. of poems to expand. I need to be expansive.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you.
Great. Yeah, welcome. All of them.
My name is Mia, and I'm not much of a performer because I also get terrified when I'm from an audience, but there are two things. I tend to rely on visuals when I have to read, so I usually try to put up some kind of image or a PowerPoint or something, and I also try to dress nicely. At least feel like there's something nice to look at. Actually, the most mortifying reading I've ever done was I didn't realize it was going to be at a nightclub in Amsterdam.
Mm.
And it was filled with, like, there were, like, 100 people, very hip people, and I was 7 months pregnant. So I go up, and I'm followed, and there's, like, dead silence the whole time, followed by a man who actually had these finger musical things.
Oh, like Ed Sanders style?
Like the Sanders. And so that was kind of that. So I always am... confronted with how unhip I am at these things.
Well, reading is often an exercise objection, right? So, do you want to participate? No? Okay. We wanted to ask you, how many of you actually brought a piece in? Okay, you have. So some of you have, some of you haven't. So we thought maybe we could start with a writing prompt. So that those of you who haven't, brought anything in can produce something we can discuss. So we want to play you a slightly longer, like maybe 5-7 minute Ann Carson video to write through. So to use that as a kind of prompt.
Excuse me. Do you want me to read one because I have to leave now? If I wouldn't be able to wait.
Okay. All right. Well, I don't want to. Sure, sure. That's okay. So let's hear you, and then if you have to leave us, then that's what we'll do. Do you want the mic?
No, I'm no? loud enough.
To be, it's for recording.
Okay.
Just one poem.
One poem is fine. Okay. It's called Attila, the President for Life of the East. Your name means daddy in Old Germanic. You talk down to me from horseback, as if I'm a pope who's defending Rome from you. A slab of meat is warming between your thighs and the side of the horse. Your wispy beard is singed by the camera lights when they interview you on CNN. Daddy, though I left your country half a lifetime ago, I can never escape your reach. Your arrows and missiles blot out the sun and the moon in my dreams. All roads lead to Rome, Daddy. You are coming for me.
Okay, thank you.
The majority of the people have, though, right?
Well, these people don't know here. Okay, so let's. So what we're going to do is, whether you brought something or not, maybe this is a good time to write something as well. So we're going to play you this video by Ann Carson, and. The prompt is simply to free write in response to the video. So anything that you want to do with it, the floor is yours.
Because I have Audrey's poem, and it's really good.
Okay.
So I wanted to perform it.
Wait, no, you can't.
Oh, I need a mic. I can't.
This
hands.
No. Audrey, can you perform
it? Here, I'll hold it.
Okay. I don't need you, Audrey. Sit down.
Audrey should relax and observe her critique.
I came up it's my title for her poem. It's called What It's Like to Fight and Realize You Are Indeed Your Mother. I don't know. Is this a hand? Maybe two hands? A kiwi? In the grass? Maybe grass hands. You said it was a kiwi and a vortex, which resembles a family of vortexes, vortices. Heavenly around a body, which I imagine is you. I don't know. Or maybe it's me, or your mother, or a kiwi. My mother looked a lot like Mickey Mouse in drag. Set against grass, green, knuckle mountains, only we were alone on this island, would dictate a library written in a language you don't know or know how to speak. Sorry, you say. Nice dress, you say. Nice kiwi. Thank you.
Woohoo! All right.
Is any other group ready to go, or do you guys want some more
you
time?
You want a few more minutes? How do you feel?
Maybe you should perform a dance.
Yeah.
I'm ready.
Did you say a dance?
Yeah, he's going to perform. She's going to perform dance poem because he's leaving. Excellent. Can you hold it for me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hold up the nose.
All right. Spit 15 times into a mouth of glass teeth. Adonai, 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 Adonai. Adonai, 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 Adonai. Close your hips around absent vowels, Dainu.
Woo! All right. Damn, quick work. Okay.
Sorry, I can't stay.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
So
it was great.
Thanks
so much.
It was really fun.
Thank you so much for coming.
Have fun. Let's give him a few more moments.
A few more moments,
few more
says
moments?
Anna.
They seem to still be working, so let's not disrupt the flow.
Good news.
Guess what you want?
I want to.
Tell me about it. Do you want to go away for one sec?
Manas.
No? No. We're going down, right? now, Sophia le Fraga as Melanie Jordan Jackson, and performing on sets.
Maybe I should do it for like a less intense briefing than UPenn.
Maybe. I think you should present your work at UPenn, because UPenn is important. I think they should see your work. But this is where your work too. You can do one piece.
Like, I would love to perform
the hammer. Why don't you perform that?
Plus, like, everyone knows it, you know what I mean? Everyone mm-hmm. there will know it, so it'll be like...
Mm-hmm. Maybe.
I want to talk to Lynn about my performance. Mm-hmm. Now what? Let's check our tree.
So, take a couple more minutes, and then we'll hear you all.
Yeah, that's exactly.
So it's 9:30, so we have to be there.
Same time.
Same time, 9:30. Okay, we can do that. That's bomb?
Yeah.
You have plenty of time to get there. We need about a good half an hour to get there, so like, we should just like maybe have a snack around here.
Probably will take us out.
Maybe.
I think we should like make an effort.
Yeah.
Pretty camp.
Okay, so I think we should go ahead and hear your performative critiques. So, who wants to go? Do you guys want to? Should we go? Should we go counterclockwise and continue with you guys?
I can go, or if anyone else wants to go.
Mm-hmm. Anyone eager to? You want to go?
Yeah.
Okay, guys. Let's do it.
Okay. So, should I stand up here?
Yep,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Or should I sit down? Does it matter?
Well, it's your
floor. Performance.
It's your stage, so, it's your pick.
However you think is best perform.
Okay, I need to think outside the box here. This is Judy's piece. A lace, plush. Over alien skin, salivate tears, thinking about saying rape. Pony blood, another. Repay, make, whisper, sell, change pronoun over, whistle, whistle, whistle. Beneath hums, ears, vibrate. The sounds of the body contradict. The body makes, the body whispers. Shadows are not innocent. If only sex, always, behind knees and knuckles, the coins are dropped, I and not I, windows, elements, eyes, a pink burning and an open tree.
Amazing. Woo! Woo-hoo! Wow, that was great. Floor is yours.
Following that, this is Kevin's poem.
liquid, liquid, liquid. Words, words, words. Hers, hers, hers. Languid, languid, languid. Inflammation, inflammation, inflammation. Ozone, ozone, ozone. Inhalation, inhalation, inhalation. Hours, hours, hours. Cells, cells, cells. Ratio, ratio, ratio. Cancer, cancer, cancer. Hers, hers, hers. Interruption, revise, interruption, revise, interruption, revise.
Nice. You want to go? Yeah?
This is Mia's poem. Drink me, plush pony tears. Bow breath thy summer, another god day. Bow breath thy other bananas. Urgent language, if only you were alone, you were a hyphen.
Was it a drastic revision? No. Okay.
It was interesting because it was all text from persons. It was kind of multiple levels.
Great. Mia, do you want to? Did you critique Mary's? Yeah. Okay. You want to go next?
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. It's again
it's your
performance.
Okay.
Whatever you want to do.
That's already saying a lot. How can I hold up the microphone while still doing this?
Here, your turn.
Excuse me.
I'll be your silent partner.
It rhymes with which has the meaning both of and one who doesn't. I like the way it goes, and too far, rocky or deep. Fish live it, trash, couch, mattress, worship. The lady maples dip there, their own reflections. And the train goes twice, and the so tall that year with sun, the Japanese like scary mobile. If her necklace walked and ate holes in her, and two, with sticky, fair ooze. It gets thin and salty near the marshes. Now I'm dining on the coast was the name of town.
That was Whoa! Amazing. Woo! See, you don't need any fancy electronic gloves to perform. You have your hands. Pally, the floor is yours. Do you want me to hold your mic, or are you good?
I think I'm good. Does it work? Yeah.
It's recording.
So this is Leah's poem. It's called Electron Pronouns. Possessive is a term that I associate with Latin class and you. So this is to you in the dative sense. Farm Animals was an internet video before YouTube. I built snow forts and ice skated with butcher blades. I don't dance, but you always want to. You turn up the radio and you dance in your private Idaho. There are lava tunnels which you crawl up like a ribbed condom or like vertebrae, whichever you prefer. Which one do you prefer?
All right.
Poem. I'm going to sit down so I don't drop his laptop.
Okay, with the mic?
Yeah. Okay. 5 letters to my genius ex-girlfriend. Modernism genre fiction. Because you knew how, presenting an inherently limited vibe, opening up the possibility of the infinity of other vibes, blinding to everything that you could not embody in yourself. And I was ashamed, novelistic, boring. And I have conceived a type of personality more perfect but the Lord, executioner. What weakness, and I knew I could make up for it by cataloging all your blindnesses and failures and your side so that ideal observers will know that Cecilia Pelli sees them clearly, stares them down. All glory to Cecilia Pelli. Second stanza. The world starts making sense for the first time when you discover that production always goes through recognition, that you're putting words together waiting to see what's going to happen, that nobody's on the inside of him or herself, his or her language, his or her understanding, but are merely or desperately punching combination in the vending machines of our omniscient selves that can check everything but generate nothing. Third stanza. Rap, game, lower limit, lived experience, upper limit, real relationship of individuals to the their imaginary conditions of existence. Fourth stanza. My daughter, my sister, my daughter, my sister, someone I don't know. Fifth stanza. I mean, what does it tell you that to chew is so much of an intellectual gamble that we bite our tongues or inner cheek sometimes? Or bite down on the fork. Fuck. My neck hurts bad today from falling asleep wrong. And I explain to myself that not knowing to explain what your work does is not more weird, not like not knowing to make the work you know you want to do. And what the person who has no lacks is just the sum of two lacks. And the person who has both is just the conjunction of having skill to run into the words that name this thing that have skill to run into words that are the thing.
Woo! Amazing. Yeah, I'll grab that. Thank you. Thank you. There we go.
Thank you. God, I promise I tore my hair out first. God, I promise I tore my hair out first. I resisted so hard, tearing up the earth. I made love because I wanted to. I tore the grass because I couldn't not tear the grass. I didn't know the earth's heart was so close to the surface. I pulled at the most perfect wrong. The most perfect wrong spot. My scalp bled as the earth imploded. This is only fantasy. But God, I did not will my mind to fight you.
All right. And
that's everyone.
Is
no?
that it? You've performed. Okay. All right.
Cool.
So I'm astonished, amazed, delighted, enthused, and I actually do want to give you a group hug. So thank you, thank you for coming out tonight and for performing your critiques. Yeah, it was great to hear your work. Thank you. Yeah, group hug, for real. Since it's Harvard.
I'll hug you.
Let's do it. Since it's Harvard, it's going to be a hypothetical group hug.
Just think about it.
Yeah. Epic.
That was amazing.